Oh, well, one thing's for sure.
Yeah. This sends our podcast
in a whole new direction. Good evening, folks. Welcome to the podcast. I'm Jade.
And I'm Erica.
And this is Perfectly Marvelous, a podcast dedicated to the hit Hulu show, Only Murders in the Building.
Yes, and today we're reviewing Season 3, Episode 5, Ah, Love.
Yes.
Yes.
So as usual, we're going to break down the episode scene by scene, but when we get into our whodunit theories, you can jump over to YouTube and watch the video of the rest of the podcast, and I highly suggest you do, because I think that getting a visual of what we're talking about is super helpful as all these clues like begin to pile up and just get, you know, really confusing. So the link will be in the description to head over to YouTube, and while you're there, please, guys, subscribe to my YouTube channel, because once we reach 1,000 subscribers, we can monetize our videos. You know, subscribing is it's free for you, and it's just super freaking helpful for us. So please and thank you, my loves. I really appreciate it. And to watch the full video of this entire podcast from start to finish, and to get access to all of our delicious bonus content, go to patreon.com/perfectlymarvelouspodcast and sign up to be one of our most marvelous members. And shout out to those most gorgeous creatures in all the land, our beautiful patrons, Lisa, Gail, Kimberly, Melanie, Liz, Kathy, Melissa, and Jane. Oh, my loves, thank you so much for your continued support. We truly, truly could not do this without you. Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, now without further ado, let's start the show, baby. Pop a squat, kumquat, because we got some murder to solve. Tits up, bitches.
Tits up.
Ah, all right. So, starting off with the opening credits, what did you notice?
Yeah, I noticed, wasn't too much.
There was one thing that I saw. Did you see it?
I saw the heart clouds.
I think that was it. I mean, elephant in the room. Let's talk about the elephant in the room, guys. Let's pull a Charles here. the elephant in the room is we are minus one Kara. So we're going to have to go full Jerrica, and the Kara will be silent. We miss you, baby.
Yes.
But Kara would tell us if we missed something on those opening credits, so we might have. But I didn't see anything else except for the smoke in the shape of hearts. Ah, love.
Yeah, ah, love.
Okay, so we start off here at the top with a voiceover from Joy asking, you know, how well do we really know our significant other? And, you know, do we really know who we're sleeping next to? And people can conceal pretty dirty secrets and fatal flaws.
Mm-hmm.
All I could think was that the theme kind of this episode is like paranoia of who you're with. And especially when you're on like a first date with someone, it's like sussing out the other person. It's like, how healthy is it to be like really cautious? Should you be trying to be yourself and letting your inhibitions just go and be present in the moment? It really got me thinking to myself, how do I present myself on a first date, and how should I present myself on a first date, you know?
Yeah, definitely. But it's been a long time since I've been on a first date. But even just meeting new people, absolutely. And how much you want to share, and you don't want to overshare. And
there have been some weird first dates on this show. I'm just thinking back of like Charles and Jan.
Mm-hmm.
And we talked about it when we covered season one, the red flag of Jan being like, so tell me your breakup story, or tell me about your last relationship. I'm like, ah.
Yeah.
Red flags.
Let's go.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So anyway, then we get this first scene of the only scene in the whole episode with our trio all together. So Oliver has a first date with Loretta, and Mabel is going out on a stakeout, not date, but totally, it's totally a date with Tobert. And so they show up at Charles' place to find out about Joy's lipstick.
Mm-hmm.
And yikes. How'd you feel about this opening moment?
I was very confused Charles. And very concerned about Charles. What was Joy doing in there? Like, that even throughout the episode, I don't know if that matched like Joy's just kind of personality, like all that aggression going on in there. I was imagining it was something just trying to get things out, but I guess she really was, you know, making art or something. It was just,
yeah.
I bet Charles was really, he must have been really scared at that moment.
I just wasn't sure. I was like, what the fuck? She is shrieking. She's loudly shattering sea glass for her aquarium. I was like, why? What? And poor Charles. I'm just like, Charles, I need Charles to get out of this relationship. Charles, blink twice if you're feeling unsafe. Are you okay?
Yeah. He looked pretty scared. I felt very bad for him. But
this was so weird because I guess it was funny, but it was more disturbing than funny. I don't know. I just got a serious like concern going on for Charles.
I know. He is such a, I don't know. Even though like throughout the episode, we find that Joy was, you know, not these things that he had in his head, that paranoia like kind of took over. It just, he's been traumatized enough with relationships. Yeah. Like, it's like he does need some alone time, I think. he needs to distance himself. He needs a break. He needs a pet.
I know. You mean like a pet, like a cuddle?
Yeah, or like a Sevelin or something, since, you know.
Oh, like a pet, like not Ralph. 62 fish.
No. Something that it could, you know, have a connection with, but doesn't come with any strings attached.
Right. Another thing I found, I was obsessed with Mabel's dress, earrings, silver clutch with little handle. I love fancy Mabel, can I just say?
She looked gorgeous.
And then when she shows up, though, and she's like, or when she says, it's not a date, I'm like, honey, that plunging neckline, that is so a date dress. Come on, Mabel. You ain't fooling anybody.
Yep. I love the interaction between Mabel and Oliver about his scarf.
Oh, my God. Okay. Another reason that I am Oliver, because I have an obsession with scarves, and I can't believe I haven't mentioned this until now, but I have some very special scarves, and I always refer to my scarf as Scarfy. And for a long time, I had like one particular scarf that was just called Scarfy, and like everyone knew that, oh, you got Scarfy on today. Like, I am obsessed with scarves.
Do you ever bring a backup scarf? I do. In case.
Oh, yes. In the wintertime, I am multiple scarfed. I am double, triple scarfed sometimes. Yes.
I love that. I thought it was hilarious. It's very cute because he's giddy. He's not hiding his like infatuation of Loretta, where Mabel is kind of like avoiding it or like, no. We're just, you know, getting together to talk about a lead. And then there's poor Charles, who's just like, I don't know what to do with myself. I don't, even with his feelings, like he doesn't know what to do with his feelings.
Yeah, exactly.
Like we find that like she has always been very outward with her feelings towards him. Like he just doesn't know what to do with himself. He needs therapy, which Saz is the MVP of this episode.
Totally. Yes. Agreed. Yep. Okay, so getting back to Oliver and Mabel, great line. It's been a while since I dipped my quill into a woman's ink pot. Any new moves I should know about?
Ew.
Oh, that was great.
If I was Mabel, I'd be like, oh, yeah, same. No.
Just the way he put that. But I love that that's like on his mind. He's like, I'm going to go out and get me some tonight. And then he flips that bed down later and he's like, oh, I didn't mean to jump the gun. Sorry about that. Like, oh, man.
Oh, my goodness.
And then another line that Joy says, better to lose your mind loving than to live your life loveless. And I'm like, is it, though? I mean, I feel like I've lived by that mantra and I don't know that it's served me that great because I've had some crazy relationships.
But you could have platonic relationships because I love my friends. I love you. Like you can have love in your life. Yes. It doesn't mean you have to have that, like, you know, that other
I lose
type
my
of love.
Mind loving you, Erica. Yeah. I certainly do.
But no, Joy just you know, obsessed.
Obsessed. A little obsessed, yes, indeed.
Yeah.
So then let's get into Charles, right? So Charles confronts Joy about the lipstick. And Saz shows up and plays commit or be committed with Charles to help him figure out his feelings for Joy.
I love that Saz is a host again because Jane Lynch, you know, we love her and she was a host in Marvelous Mrs. Maisel.
I got so excited.
Yes.
You bring Jane Lynch on and you know that's going to make me happy.
Oh my God.
I was like, yes.
Yes. And I love this character. It could be so annoying, so repetitive, but.
Oh, yeah.
It's such a caricature. But no, Saz has some good feelings in there. But I really did enjoy this scene. This scene was great. But I really felt bad for Joy. I don't blame her for being upset to be confronted about like all the different things. But I also think she's so blinded by her love and obsession over Charles that she doesn't see like why he's acting so weird.
Well, yes, I have two minds about Joy because she's very passive aggressive, which is really her reaction was so extra to Charles's why do you think that happened? Why do you think that the lipstick would have gotten backstage? You know, can you explain that? And she was just like, maybe Saz wants to be interrogated. And I like the third degree. And I'm like, he literally asked you in the most gentle way possible.
That is
the
true.
Most gentle way. If you knew about this lipstick and how it got backstage, I thought that she was in this first bit. Anyway, this first scene, I thought she was way out of line personally for me. I mean, I get toward the end.
Yeah.
Where she could be upset. But yeah, this first scene, I was like, Joy, what? I did not like her.
She's intense. She's an intense character, but like she seems even more so. Like even after like the ending scene, like the last shot of the last episode where like it was just a big hyper close up of her face. And you're like, they're really throwing her in our face to see that she looks quite disturbed. But you're right.
They're going out of their way to write Joy to look insane, like unhinged, batshit crazy. So obviously we can write her off. She's definitely not the killer. We've been saying it. I never thought she was. But for sure, by now, we know she's not the killer.
She probably needs therapy. She probably does just because of this kind of like unhealthy relationship with Charles. Because it doesn't seem really good.
No, it does not. It's not healthy.
It's not mutual. Like it's
And what you were saying about her not really seeing that Charles is like going through something right now. He's afraid to do this Broadway show. He's got all these other things on his mind. Like, Joy, he's right there in front of you. Like, use your eyes and ears and understand that he needs some time now. Mm-hmm. And maybe this is not the best moment for you to just get all uppity and make it all about you and take things so personally. I don't know. I just thought that she was, for what she says, you know, I'm trying to be so open and have an open dialogue. And I'm like, my ass, you are trying to have an open dialogue. Like, I do not see, no.
Hot takes on Joy. Yeah, no, I actually really do agree with you. Like, I could see where as the episode progressed, like you're supposed to feel a little bit sorry for her. But it is true. Charles, if she knows Charles and they've been together for what, a year now? It's their relationship was at least a year. She knows what Jan did to him. She knows even just that. That was not that long ago. He was almost killed.
if she needs a little under sensitivity towards Charles' situation.
And his coworker was killed. And this episode like revealed so much about Charles and his involvement with Ben that I think that even though she wasn't aware of it, but she's part of the cast. She does makeup. She should be aware that this is not a good time. She's very delusional. She's very much centered around her own little world and her happy little, what is it, 52 fish? 62
fish.
62 fish. 62 fish.
But I thought of you, Erica, when... that poor fish. She says she doesn't tolerate bullies. When she took that fish abuse, I'm sorry.
Was so
I was
scared.
Like,
I was
my scared. Little Pisces heart, I thought of you, you know, Pisces buddies. And I was like, stop, you're hurting the fish. Don't do that to him.
I agreed. I was like, oh no, don't you dare flush that fish down this or something. I was worried. You're right.
She was like, President McKinley, you're in timeout. I'm like, stop doing your abusing the fish. Yeah, no, it's not okay, man.
No.
She needs to not have that many fish.
She needs to
chill. Some people shouldn't be parents. Some people shouldn't be fish owners.
Yes.
But, you know, what you're saying about understanding where Joy's coming from, I get that Joy is upset because Charles proposed by accident. And that was a gut punch for her. Mm-hmm. I have a hard time believing that he actually proposed, but I guess we're taking this as fact.
I don't understand the ring, though. Like, where did that come from?
Oh, we had some listener feedback, actually. I will read that now. It was from Miko5191. They said the ring came on YouTube. They said the ring came from the fish tank at the beginning of that scene. She showed him a treasure chest and she was adding to the tank, which contained a ring on a chain. That's where he got the ring from.
And is that where the pearls kind of came from as well? Because he had pearls on his head or something.
Yeah, okay. That's it. Really? Yep. When I went back and rewatched it. Yeah. Miko5191, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. I love that. Yeah, because where did that come from unless she planted it? I mean, it wasn't a diamond ring, but still, it was very fishy, pun intended. Yeah, so I don't know.
And it's strange, too, because I was just starting to kind of get on board with Charles and Joy as a couple. I was like, you mm-hmm. know, I kind of like her for him, you know, even though I didn't totally agree with her delusionally putting on that ring and accepting a proposal from a guy who is obviously in a state. He's throwing mm-hmm. things around a room, got no pants on. He's proposing to you in this. Like, I mean, I guess, though, that Joy is so extroverted and, you know, just extra in every way mm-hmm. that I guess she's like, oh, Charlie's finally on my level and proposing mm-hmm. to me in this like ecstatic, you know, right. insane way. Probably that was kind of what she wanted from
him. She's also dismissive of his trauma in a way, because like, remember when he was doing Patter song. Mm-hmm. Thank you. And he was like, the omelet was actually
helping him.
It was a way he was going to self-regulate and get him focus. It's just like, no, that's a crutch. Focus on me. That's like all she
that's
wants
what I'm
him.
Saying yeah,
because she so loves him so much, even though her world doesn't, you know, really evolve around him, but she does love him so much, she wants it to be mutually, let's, you know, focus on her. But yeah,
I just couldn't get behind everything that she was saying about the wanting to be open. And because the last episode, Charles wanted to check in about living together, and she mm-hmm. quickly brushed it off like, it's only been 48 hours. What are you saying, honey? What's your point? And then he goes into this manic state and proposes to her. I mean, I guess Joy is not capable of this kind of emotional understanding that Charles clearly needs, but where I can see her point and how she is hurt, I also, more of me is on Charles's side, and I'm just kind of like, okay, I'm glad that this is over. Like, please get away from my Charles.
Yeah.
That
relationship is just not healthy. Not at all.
But a relationship that is healthy, that I love to see, is, like you were saying, Saz to the rescue, you know, mm-hmm. although she does not know all of the information, and she only kind of serves to get Charles to think that he does really want to be with Joy, which mm-hmm. it is, you know, questionable. Mm. I do love their friendship. I love the Saz and Charles, you know, whenever they get together, it's just so
cute. It's adorable. And it is.
So I got to bring up here my most marvelous moment when Saz plays commit or be committed with Charles, and she imitates Joy. I need sex twice a day, three times on weekends. I was shocked at how Jane Lynch perfectly imitated Andrea Martin's voice mm-hmm. and mannerisms. I was like, Jane Lynch, you are a fucking rock star. Mm-hmm. So here you go.
Remember, I'm Joy.
Ooh, there. I need sex twice a day, three times on weekends. Wrong answer. Nothing wrong with the supercharged sex drive, Charles. Our next category is the future. You are my future. And I'll never, ever leave you, Charlie. Ever. Never.
Never.
Ever.
Mm-hmm. Oh, my God. And the way he's that she uses, like, the fish tank lights.
Yes. But do you see him? Like, he's like,
Right.
Yeah.
He's like, not, yeah.
Yeah, she's a little too much. She might be really good for Saz.
Right? See, Saz can handle this. See, that's what I'm saying. Saz, mm-hmm. you need to understand that you and Charles are not the same person. Where I do think that Charles needs someone who is over the top, extroverted. He does like this. He loves himself a highly charged, highly sexual woman. And can I say, by the way, Andrea Martin is so sexy. And those mm-hmm. leather pants, she is gyrating those hips. I'm like, get it, Andrea Martin. God damn, you are a hot mama. I love her so much. But yeah, I think, yeah, Charles, he does not, this was not really great advice from Seth, sadly.
No. Although, we do find out, what does Saz do? She reveals that she's still seeing Jan.
This made me so happy. Yes. Can I just say? Because when, you know, when we were talking about season, or no, was it in, yeah, when we were talking about season one, I was saying how I really wanted Charles and Jan to be together, and like I needed that to happen. I was still shipping them even though Jan was in jail. And then we started talking about, well, she could get with Saz though, and I was like, oh, I think this is actually better.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's a little better. Safer. It's right.
Yeah, but yep. Plexiglass or sexy glass according to
I know.
what did Saz say? Like
she says, there's only so much you can do with a raised eyebrow, wet lips, and a sliver of tit.
Hell yeah. Well, we saw that when she took down one button.
Yeah, right.
love Jape Lynch. I doubt it. I think that was just a little tiny nugget they were giving us. I would love to see a Saz and Jan
like spinoff. Give me the spinoff. Yes. Yes. Yeah, the one good thing that really came out of this was Charles, and it was very sad, Charles discovering he's afraid of his own happiness. Mm-hmm. And I think that's so relatable, that like fear of commitment is fear of, it's tied to your fear of success. Mm-hmm. It's so relatable.
It's a weird fear. It's easier to, what's the word I'm looking for? Like to self-sabotage and to just constantly like destroy his own happiness. It's just easier for him to, I don't think process, but at least gets him away. It's an escape for him.
Yeah, sometimes the hardest thing in life, and it's just a crazy concept, is to get out of your own way. It's so much harder than it sounds.
Yeah. Charles. I want them all to have happy endings. I think that is all I want in the end. Happy.
All I want too.
Yeah.
Seriously. Aww. Okay. Well, Mabel has quite the happy ending this episode because she goes on her stakeout, not date, but totally date. And they see Jonathan singing and he meets this mysterious Dr. C.
Yeah. Mm.
They have some kind of an exchange. What did you make of this?
Yeah. You know my thoughts on Tobert. I don't trust him at all. I think he's super shady. He lies a lot. He's very manipulative. He knows how to get Mabel. Like, he's smart. And I mean, he's very handsome. He's very attractive. So he uses it to his advantage. But like, it was like that whole, it was very calculated.
It was quite manipulative.
Yeah.
He misled her about having a lead just to get her on the date.
Yeah.
But Mabel did seem like she was kind of in the mood to be misled.
Yeah. I still don't trust him. I feel like because when she came in, I mean, his back was towards her rather than up. Like, and then he let her sit there and move. And I mean, I don't know if that's just because he was watching Jonathan because supposedly he's his biggest fan. I don't know if I buy that. There's something really interesting about that. And I know it ties in the thoughts about Ralph because Jonathan and Ralph. Like, you know, so I don't know. I just don't trust Tobert at all.
Jonathan and Ralph, you mean Howard?
That's what I mean. Thank you, Howard.
I know what you meant?
Ralph,
I mean, exactly,
is Maisel. You know who I'm talking about. Yeah. So Jonathan and Howard. So it's just like, I don't know. There's just too many little people connected to Tobert now. Like, he knows about Dr. C. He knows about Jonathan. He knows about, like, all these little things.
Well, he knows about... So this Dr. C thing, I'm not really sure what to make of this because if we're to take Tobert at his word, it was a celebrity concierge doctor, you know, seeing Ben several times a year. And it's kind of easily explained away. Obviously, it looks like if this is the case, then Jonathan is buying some kind of a prescription from him. But why?
Why did they run... And also, but why would they run away so quickly when
they
noticed them?
That was so awkward.
It was so weird.
He literally just, like, looked, didn't even say... Oh, hi, Mabel. And then like slyly go, maybe we should step over here. He literally just looked at Mabel and just like turned the other way.
Yeah.
I was like, that's so obviously suspicious. What is happening? It was very
like,
funny.
Like Mabel doesn't know who that Dr. C is. She knows who Jonathan is. It was too suspicious. So weird.
I guess Jonathan could have put it together that Tobert knows Dr. C.
Maybe.
Because Dr. C is from Ben, you know, that's probably, maybe that's how Jonathan got the connection.
Maybe.
But no, I mean, Jonathan wasn't close with Ben.
Yeah.
We don't really know, but it doesn't make any sense. I don't know what to make of this.
That whole thing just kind of like went, What is going on here? Yeah.
And, you know, the most odd thing about it was he hugged the guy. He mm-hmm. hugged Dr. C.
That I don't hug my doctor unless it's a really good doctor.
Yeah. And especially not because this doctor is more drug dealer than doctor.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. There was something interesting about that. I mean, I wonder if it connects it to Dickie because Dickie hasn't been around. But yeah, so I think we'll have to see. The only other thing about Taubert is he's the one who wrote down Dr. C's name for the murder board, which feels like I said, I feel like he's very manipulative. That's like he's forcing him onto the murder board. So like that wasn't Mabel putting him up there.
Well, Mabel wanted it put up there, though. I mean, it was a clue. It's a clue.
But it's like, but it's Taubert putting his hand in it. So it kind of like, does it mean anything more? I don't know. I don't know if he's a murderer. I don't know if he's a murderer in it, but I feel like he is so more involved.
He's definitely imposing himself onto the situation.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Oops. Sorry, Siri. I don't care what you feel about this, but, but yeah. And, we know they enjoy each other's company afterwards.
Yes. They take it to Pound Town.
He also was, you know, and again, like you said, Mabel was very much seemed like she was looking forward to this, but also just like, the drinks involved, like, you know, I just noticed that, like, he already took the liberty of ordering her something to drink. And
no, he didn't. He ordered food, but he didn't know her drink yet.
Ah, shit.
And then
okay.
when she ordered a mezcal old fashioned, I was like, yes, Mabel, my kind of girl, mezcal, get it. I'm a tequila babe myself, 100% all the time. Do not drink unless it's good tequila.
Never again.
You got to drink the good stuff. You got to drink the good stuff. Then you don't get a hangover. I'm telling you, tequila's good. Yeah, so I wish one thing out of this exchange, I wish Mabel had asked him how he started working for Ben. How did he get this gig with Ben? It's something that we've been speculating on, and I just can't imagine how he goes from Botswana elephant animal wildlife documentary to Ben, following Ben around. Mm-hmm. Like, that's such a jump. I mean, I guess if the paycheck is right, then you'll do anything.
Yeah. Yeah, you know. But then again, like, maybe he has connections within Hollywood, and that's why. Maybe they'll come to light because if he knows who this doctor to the stars or whatever he is, then maybe he has more connection than we know.
Yeah, good point.
I'm curious who else knows him.
Yeah, I know. Obviously, Dickie's going to know him, and we just haven't gotten a lot of Dickie.
Mm-hmm.
Wish we had more. Really wish we had more. They're hiding him for a reason, though, and it's making me suspicious.
Mm-hmm.
Anything else about this? Oh, I love Jonathan's voice. Can I just say he's very Louis Armstrong, and it was it was wonderful.
Oh, it's so much. It's like so deep and gravelly, and so like it's sensuous. It's beautiful. Yeah. I love it.
Jason VC, you have an amazing voice, sir. You are a very talented man.
Yes, you are.
Sing me anything. Sing me to sleep, baby.
Mm-hmm.
All right, so let's talk about the hot topic of the moment here. This date with Oliver and Loretta. So, okay.
What's her ship date? Name? Oloretta?
Oloretta? Oh, they both have such complex, like, lot of syllable names. So what would it be? Oloretta or Loraliver? Ooh, I like Loraliver.
Loraliver.
Loraliver. So they have their first date at Loretta's house, and then Oliver loses his tooth in a pork chop.
Oh, God.
Goodness gracious.
That was horrible. That was not a crown either. That was a freaking tooth.
That was like a fucking tooth.
So
I just want to say, when was the last time Oliver chewed solid food? His teeth are not used to it. He couldn't handle it.
Oh, my God.
He was afraid to, too. He knew it. He was like, I love chewing on a chop. Sounds good. Yeah, serve it up. I was like, no.
Oh, my God. No, please don't.
But good Lord, was he a good sport about that. Wow.
He is.
I would not have taken that so well.
No, because that hurt. That physically hurt me. That's
the sound it made as it like came out, too. That like sticky kind of like, oh, it was a sound. Oh, I didn't.
No, that's a painful, painful thing. I've lost crowns. So I'm like, to tooth. Oh, God. It was. Oh, that was bad.
Yeah, I was getting like goosebumps when I heard that tooth come out of his mouth.
But I did love his whistle. His little whistle was so cute.
I know, and they're just so cute together. Mm-hmm. Did you find it odd that Loretta was like, so yeah, first date, the intention here is pork chops in the microwave. Sounds like a rockin' first date. It's like you go out, you go to a restaurant, you're in New York, the greatest food in the world.
I was very surprised that they had their first date at her house. I really, really was.
It was a little contrived. But I mean, I guess not even really that. Was there a reason? I'm trying to think now. What was the reason to get Oliver to come over to her house? Because they could have had that pork chop tooth pull out moment at a restaurant easily. Mm-hmm. But I don't know. I guess it was just to like endear Oliver to Loretta more. Because as soon as he came in, he was like, it's art. I love it. And he said his Oliver line, who are you? Mm-hmm. Which he said to Mabel the first night they met. And I was reminded of that.
Yeah.
He loves himself a unique and mysterious lady.
He does.
He appreciates the unique creatures of the world.
Yes, he does. And it was very cute.
Oliver and I have similar taste in women.
He also, like, I think that allowed, and again, I don't know if it was forced, but like, yeah, her apartment is beautiful.
It was so cool.
And so big.
It was a studio, but it was a very cool.
Yeah. She's got a cool Murphy bed, too, which is. Yeah. You know, I'm like, woo.
And that little reading nook. I was like, I want that so bad.
I know. I loved it. Very eclectic. It's just the way she dresses, too. It matches her really well. They did a really good, like, job of, like, just kind of dressing everything, her environment and her, like, match really, really well.
So then they go on the ferry. Loretta takes him on the ferry. They spark a doobie. Mm-hmm. And then they fall even more deeply in love.
And that doobie was my marvelous moment.
Yes, it was. All right, let me get.
Look at Jordan's purple rolling pin.
I know.
Groovy doobie.
Do you doobie, baby? My 12th roommate, Babette Claus, gave me this back in 1978.
And can I just say, if that joint is from 1978, good Lord, you're going to have a headache when you smoke that shit. Yeah. I was like, I don't smoke it.
And it's made with a purple streamer.
I know. I'm like, you can't. Is that possible? Is that? I don't know if that's possible, but I
don't. It makes a fun story.
Yeah.
Is that the chorus girl that got struck by lightning, skinny dipping in Central Park? Oh, okay.
I know.
This is insane. Mm-hmm. I rolled 10 joints for Babette using a purple streamer from Studio 54 that year at Grace Jones.
Was it her 30th birthday?
Yes.
I was at that party.
No, you were not.
Yes, I was. Oh, my God. That's the only time I ever got in there.
This is ridiculous. I can't believe this. I think I rolled that joint. Now sparking, baby.
Wow.
It's just so cute.
It was really cute. I love it. And we actually got an expanded Oliver story.
Yes. Can I just say, I say it all the time. Grace Jones' 50th birthday party at Studio 54. I want Oliver's life.
I do too. I love Studio 54.
Oh, yes.
There's times I think I just want to go back in time. I want to live back then, but I would like to just kind of go back in time. And
I don't know that I would have survived it because I definitely would have been partaking in all of the party favors, but it would have had a lot of fun anyway.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was a lot. Like, the Loretta Oliver scenes were like the meat of this episode.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, like there was so much. So much.
So I'm a little bit starting to question Loretta's attraction to Oliver. Sadly, I don't want to question it, but she lied about these, you know, auditioning for all of his plays. You know, my ponytail got stuck, and then Bernadette Peters gave me a water bottle laced with Valium, and he's like, you just made all that up. And she's like, yeah, maybe I did. But it was a lie. So it got me to think when she said, maybe I'm cursed. You know, she's like, oh, now I can't get a job to save my life. And, you know, your accent's too authentic. And I'm like thinking to myself, Loretta, no one's going to tell you your accent's too authentic because we all saw her accents and we're like, those are questionable at best. But she's talking about not being able to get these jobs. And I'm just thinking to myself, so you turn down this network job as a lead on a TV show. I'm like, something just tells me that there was never a job.
Is she a woman scorned, though? Do you think that there's something? Because she's like kind of like I saw some parallels between her and Joy a little bit because she was there at that party. She was there's some connection between Loretta and Oliver, like their paths must have crossed at some time.
Right.
And these, I feel like she's lying and manipulating some of it, but like maybe there's some, she's also obsessive, obviously. We find out later when we see the scrapbook that maybe there's something that ties it, and maybe she wants to get back at somebody, and Oliver is either the one she wants to get back at, or she's going to use him to get to where she wants to get to. I'm seeing that.
I'm just not sure. There's something there, though. It's like, yeah, everything that you're saying, I'm like, possibly.
There's something. I don't know necessarily. Like, here's the thing. Like, I mean, she absolutely 100% seems like she could be the killer at this point. But like, it's like, so we're only at the fifth episode. And then the big reveal, like she does the fucking pig, that whole thing, fucking pig. And we're like, right. Oh, and they did so really well, like showing Oliver flashing back to the fucking pig thing and hers. And then we saw the actual flashback to them fighting. So right. they're giving us actual now evidence that we're seeing of their interaction before the show opened.
Now, going back a second, before we get to that flashback of what happened between her and Ben, did you think it was odd that she said, she was talking about the pigs, you know, and she's doing her little snort and, you know, mm-hmm. Meryl Streep, what can't you do? She did that.
She played
snort,
a pig. Like, what did she say? She was a pig on a cruise. And then,
oh, yeah, in the Charlotte's Web cruise ship production. And then she was Snowball in Animal Farm, in a Black Box Animal Farm. I'm like, yes, I need to see this.
Oh, Black Box shows.
Yeah. But I thought it was strange the way that she said, you know who is a real fucking pig? Ben Glenroy. Mm-hmm. And let's toast to him. And then when he asks her about it, she goes, well, let's not talk about Ben now. I'm like, you brought it up, bitch. What are you doing? Why? That struck me as so odd as to why she would bring that up and then immediately be like, I don't want to talk about it. So I don't know what to make of this.
Were they drinking at that point?
Yeah.
Okay.
That's something.
So she could have possibly been a little drunk, and that's why. Or like, again, I feel like everything is so intentional. Like they're intentionally trying to move things around, and then no. And like kind of like say, no, I wasn't doing that. And no, I don't want to talk about them. But yet you're the one that brought it up. Is it the writing, or is it like there's some intent in there? Like she wanted to bring him up. She wants Oliver to, because she doesn't know that Oliver saw that fucking pig thing yet, or does she?
Well, I don't think so. That's one thing that I can say. She did not write fucking pig. Why would you incriminate yourself like that? I don't think that she knew about it at all. Because, she's not stupid, you know?
No.
But, okay. So let's talk about what happened between her and Ben. What did you make of this flashback? We know it's a true flashback because we see it from Charles' perspective as well. So that made me happy. I was like, okay. Because at first I was like, well, we can't believe this flashback though. It's, you know, unreliable narrator. And then I was like, oh no, we can believe it because that is exactly what happened.
But I love that they did that.
We don't know. Me too. We don't know the moment before though.
Mm-hmm.
All we know is that it looked like to me, well, let's watch it, shall we?
I appreciate that because that was a heavy scene. And they all look so good. They're all in their full, you know, makeup and costume ready to open.
Yes, right?
I'm like, come on. I want to see that show.
All right. So let us put on your Sherlock costume, put on your detective hat, and let us watch the evidence and see what we can make of it all together now.
Okay. So we're high and we're drunk.
We're high and we're drunk. Yes. Mm-hmm. It is late at night. I love that they quoted Edna St. Vincent Millay. We were very tired. We were very merry. We went back and forth all night on the ferry. I was like,
love it.
One of my favorite poets. All right.
That was a very specific turtle phrase you used. Fucking pig.
Yeah, shit, because I did call him that. We had a fight. Yeah. Just half an hour before he went on the stage that night.
Oh, no!
He said that I was obsessed with him and that I had wormed my way into the show and that he didn't really want to share the stage with a no-name. So I snapped. You fucking pig.
Let go of me, you fucking pig!
The last thing I said to him before he collapsed.
Oh,
that I was far from the only person in that theater who felt that way about him. He was an asshole to everybody.
Justifying your actions. Mm-hmm. Very quick to do that. I'll keep watching.
But you know what? Even the evidence in the very end with the scrapbook, like maybe she's a stalker and he like single white femaled herself a little bit and to get into this play so she could be near him. And that could be why he hated her so much, especially when he saw her.
I mean, it's possible. Mm. I'm not saying it's not possible. Yeah. It's not what I think, but it's possible.
Okay.
It is.
His kind-hearted brother.
Mm-hmm. Vicky.
But I'm really sorry you didn't get your opening night.
And I'm sorry he was terrible to you. I adore you, Loretta Lucky Durkin. Everything about you.
It's so cute. Mm-hmm.
Apart from that pork chop, I'll never forgive you for this.
Yeah, seriously. So, you know, she does get Oliver's sympathy, though. You know, she's an actor, you know? And this is one thing that I really hate about being an actor is that if you're really emotional or if you're really in a state, you know, or something, people can always look at you and go, oh, there goes the actor. Mm-hmm. And I'm always like, I'm feeling something over here. What the fuck? And people always can put that on you. And I hate that, you know, stop doing that to actors.
I agree.
But at the same time, when you say that, you're not wrong. Actors can manipulate. It's what we do. Right. You know, we are manipulating our emotions for a living and we are manipulating you, the audience, to feel a certain way. It's our job. You know, we get you to feel, we evoke emotion. So she does it a really good job of getting Oliver on her side. But let's just go back for a second and look at this. Look at this moment with Ben, what he is doing to her.
Mm-hmm. On the stage that night.
What the hell was that?
He looks like. Is he trying to push her off the lighthouse?
It's what it kind of looks like. He really looks like he is trying to push her over that balcony. Mm-hmm. He's like shaking her a little bit. Mm-hmm. I just don't know what to make of it.
That was very violent. They brought us back to that. Yeah, I don't either. I don't.
I mean, what could have put them into this position? Like, even if you have a stalker, even if someone is single white femaling you, do you do that? Is that the resort that you resort? It just seems like to get so desperate as to be a man putting your hands on a woman, mm-hmm. almost pushing her at a height of which, you know, she could maybe not die, but she'll get really injured if she mm-hmm. falls over that balcony. Like, what could put him in that state?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm very confused. And I know this is, I don't want to go on a tangent on this. It just kind of made me think about it. It's like I almost hope Loretta might not be the full murderer, only because I hate one. Oliver has the tell. Like they had that whole thing. Like he's so good at reading people and understanding. Besides breaking his heart because he loves her, but like just to see him so manipulated, and he's been manipulated. Like look, Teddy, his ex-wife. Like he has been. So
sure.
I kind of hope that. Not that she's an innocent, but I hope that there's something that kind of else connects it, that some of this is true and authentic, that it's not just that she's some horrible murderer.
I'm the first person to hope that her and Oliver are going to be happy together, but there's so much here.
Against them both, but yeah.
Yeah.
The truth is the first fatality.
Yeah, of the relationship. It's the first cat. The first
casualty,
casualty.
Yes.
Yes. Yep. There was also something I noticed, the mother stuff where it's the mom's tradition, mm-hmm. throwing the tooth, you know, the tooth fairy, which mm-hmm. was very corny but adorable. Mm-hmm. And yeah, you know, Kara brought it up, all the mom symbolism, all the mom stuff this season. It's very mom heavy. So
and if they are like just because of Kara's theory, like maybe there's some type of connection relationship, it would make a lot of sense why she has that book.
Right. So getting into this book, there was quite a lot here. I didn't know if I should take these specific articles as clues or not. There was an article.
Did you read the one that was in the credits? I zoomed it up and I looked at it and I read it. It was really hard.
Yeah. Okay. Listeners, audience members, so these screeners that we have that we get to watch the episodes early, you know, they are not HD quality.
No.
They are SD at best. I mean, it is like 5 pixels and you'll be happy with it. So it's like very difficult to see. Watching this on Hulu, like proper, is a completely different experience mm-hmm. from watching these screeners. And we don't get to see subtitles, nothing. It's bare bones, man.
Yeah. But we appreciate them so much.
We love them. Yes. We're not complaining. Yeah. But what was there? Yeah. Was there anything in these articles?
So
the t-shirt article. Right?
Yeah.
He wore a t-shirt. It was t-shirt. To
beat the Pope. Yeah. T-shirt gate. He wore an offensive shirt and it said man whore. Like it was like, but it, I think like
to meet the Pope.
Like, to meet the Pope. And it was, and the only thing I could find, it was designed by Skunk, but like the article did not give anything. The one thing I thought was funny is they called him an A-lister. Is he considered an A-lister? I guess. I mean, maybe. I don't know. But, like, that's really all I got from that one. And that's what they used in the credits, along with the lipstick.
Yeah, right. And the credits are usually clues. Mm-hmm. I mean, they have been in the past. So,
yeah.
I mean, not, like, huge clues, but, like, they're saying, look at this, look mm-hmm. here, this, pointing to this. Yeah. The biggest thing that I took from that book was Dickie was also in all of the photos behind Ben. So
very true.
Yeah, very easily could have been Loretta tracking Dickie instead of just tracking Ben. Maybe mm-hmm. both of them, but I don't think it should be ignored, the fact that Dickie was there in all those photos and articles.
Another
article was Hollywood is abuzz with the news that heartthrob Ben Glenroy is best known for his hit TV show Girl Cop has backed out of next week's appearance on Celebrity Jeopardy. Sources close to the actor and current spokesperson for an anti-gingivitis mouthwash said he didn't realize that the show wasn't scripted. Ben can barely remember to wipe his own ass. Do you think he knows the difference between this is hard to read, homogeneous or heterogeneous something, or even which letter his own name begins with? So it was not a complimentary article. Yeah.
Not nice at all.
He didn't want to do Celebrity Jeopardy because it wasn't scripted. And then
of course he
didn't. Ben Glenroy walked us through what he eats every day, and it's crazy. Lots of mangoes. Oh, there's the mangoes again. Mm-hmm. And then there was, on the mangoes page, it said, category is dropouts. Answer is, who is Ben Glenroy? So he dropped out of school, I guess. But then another one said that he was giving a speech at a mm-hmm. St. Louis high school or something.
Yeah.
So, and then another one, another page said, Glenroy announces plans to take center stage. So she clearly knew about the play.
Yeah. He's following him.
He had these Broadway dreams article. So yeah, there was a lot here.
Lots of stuff.
I don't know. All right, let's get into theories because I can't wait any longer.
Mm-hmm.
So listeners, if you would like to get a visual of all of the evidence that we are about to go into here when we talk about theories, then click on over to our YouTube video of the rest of this podcast. But, there's a but coming. If you do that, if you watch the video, you can only do it if you subscribe to the channel. All right, or else the deal's off. Seriously, guys, it really helps me out if you support what we do here. If you're a fan of Only Murders in the Building, it's completely free for you to subscribe to my YouTube channel. And it's a win-win situation. I'm only going to be producing more and more great content about mysteries. We have film reviews coming up, and it's all going to be on my YouTube channel. So go over there, watch the rest of this podcast, and subscribe, please. Thank you. Okay, so theory time. Erica, you go first.
Okay.
Who you think done it?
Okay, I am going to be that one who's like, I can't pinpoint exactly right now, but I am picking up so many different things that it's bothering me. And like, I put the murder board behind me because I'm like, there's so many people who are up there that we haven't even seen. We don't know their names, but now we're starting to get, they're giving us a little bit more like, you know, Bobo and Ty, like, who are these people? We don't know. I am going to stick with my original. I still think Taubert has some, he is more involved than they're leading us to believe. And if I'm wrong,
definitely.
I'm wrong. I just don't trust him. I think that multiple times we've caught him in lies, and either Mabel is playing along with him, or sadly, she's being led astray, like what happened with her last season with Alice. So I still think that he might really be heavily involved. I do still think it might be multiple murderers. So I think it's probably the two. Yeah. I think that the twin theory is really starting, even though reading and it wasn't my idea, I think it's making a lot of sense with what's been kind of brought to us. I really like it. I think it might make more sense to why Ben was referring to himself in the third person and why, like, somebody who is obviously dead could come back like that. So I still think that Tobert has a lot to do with it. Dickie, the only thing that bothers me is he hasn't been here. He has not.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
He is a...
And they're withholding him for a reason.
Yeah. They're either he's going to be the mastermind of this whole thing, or it's... Maybe he is a victim in this situation as well, somewhat. I don't know. It's like, I just don't... It's bothering me so much that he has not been in an episode since, what, episode two?
No. I think after that, he...
With the Loretta.
Got Loretta the job.
Yeah. But it's still...
But he's... Even when we see him, he says almost nothing.
And we don't know who he is. We don't know anything about him other than... what did Loretta call him?
Kind-hearted.
That connected the two. A little bit even more, even though we know that they obviously have some type of relationship that they shared, like, because she went with him to help her get a job. I feel like Loretta, Tobert, and Dickie are somewhat all kind of in this, like, weird triangle, and that we're going to figure this out at some point. But it's
okay.
There's just too much there. And then now with this whole thing with Jonathan, I'm like, a Dr. C, I'm like,
I know.
Maybe it's more than a few people. It's more. So I still think, now let me get this right. I'm so bad at it. There he is. I don't know. I don't trust you. I don't trust you at all.
He's a shifty one.
Yes, he is.
That Tobert. Yes.
So what do you think?
I agree. Tobert definitely knows more than he's letting on. Mm-hmm. I'm not as suspicious of him. I don't know why. I just can't get behind the Tobert, any kind of a Tobert theory. But I have a lot of evidence to back up. Well, I don't know if it's even necessarily a theory that I have. I've got an idea of what I think it is, but I want to talk about some clues first and some evidence that I have. A lot of it circles around the posters, the plays that are referenced. This is a theater season, mm-hmm. so we're getting a lot of references to plays. And what that does is it's basically like a cheap way of saying a whole... I mean, it's a quick way of saying a whole lot. So when you say As You Like It, the Shakespeare play, that comes with the whole history of... You can just put up that poster and you're sending a huge message, because... The very opening line of this whole show is "All the world's a stage and all the blah, blah, we know how that goes," right? Mm-hmm. The very first line of the whole third season is Shakespeare, mm-hmm. As You Like It. Also in the first episode, in Shakespeare times, men played all the women, mm-hmm. and you know, so we're getting a lot of these references.
And there was King Richard was mentioned, and Macbeth.
So yeah, I've got them all here. So yeah,
let me hear them all.
As You Like It is got feuding brothers, right? Mm-hmm. Duke Frederick deposes his brother Duke Senior. He exiles him. There's also disguise aspect to it. Rosalind and Celia in disguise escaping into the forest. Then in episode one, we also see the play that Loretta is highlighting lines from Salome.
Mm.
Salome shows up a whole lot. She's also reading three plays by Thornton Wilder. In the three play collection that I have, there's Our Town, Skin of Our Teeth, and Matchmaker. I couldn't really glean a whole lot from that, and I don't know that there's a lot to that because we can barely see the book. But then there's The Winter's Tale that we do see very clearly. Loretta is sitting in her little nook and she's reading The Winter's Tale. And The Winter's Tale, a king suspects his wife of having an affair and abandons his daughter to be raised by someone else, a shepherd. And then the daughter ends up marrying the king's rival. So there's this child abandonment, child being kind of adopted by someone else. So we have feuding brothers, child adoption, and we have Salome. And I'll come back to Salome. But episode two, we see a card in Ben's dressing room that says the play's the thing. And he has it in two places in his dressing room. So in Hamlet, you know, there's a play within a play. Mm-hmm. There's the brothers kill the king, you know, kills his brother to marry his wife and become king himself. And Hamlet ends up putting on a play inside a play in order to reveal his uncle's guilt. Like the play is the thing wherein I'll catch the conscience of the king.
Mm-hmm.
Hamlet attempts to kill his uncle to avenge his father. So more brothers feuding, you know. And the play inside the play, that's not for no reason.
Right.
Then there's another Hamlet quote from Greg, Something's Rotten in the State of Denmark. So there's two Hamlet things. The Richard II poster at the theater. So Richard II is a play about a king who completely abuses his power. And nobody likes him. He's a pompous ass. Richard is terrible. He treats his family like shit. He uses and discards people just without a care. He's very unemotional about, like, his uncle's death. You know, Richard might have even been the one to kill his uncle. We don't really know. But by the end of Richard II, we sympathize with this guy. We actually feel bad for him when he loses everything and he's deposed, you know. So I have a feeling that what I can relate that to is, like, is Ben Glenroy a Richard II mm-hmm. character?
Maybe.
Because he's so ego. He's on an ego trip, man. He's horrible to everyone. So I feel that maybe by the end of this show, we might be looking at Ben in a different way and having sympathy for him. I don't know. Then another poster that we see is the cherry orchard. And this other poster that's a blue poster with these big laughing mouths on it. And it's a, you can't ever see the top half of it except for one frame in Ben's dressing room, like a split second. I was like, oh, finally I see them. Because I was like, what is this poster? It's not a real poster. It's not a real play. If anyone out there can find evidence to tell that this is a real play, this menage a trois play, it's this blue poster mm-hmm. with the three laughing big open mouths. And all I can take from it is three, you know, and it comes up again. The cherry orchard as well has this mouth, these lips with biting a cherry. And the cherry orchard does involve three people kind of losing their home. There's more than three people in the cherry orchard, but the three main people lose their home. And at the end, one of them, you know, dies, gets locked in the house.
Mm-hmm.
The poor Furs, the servant, he dies. And everyone just kind of forgets about him. So there is themes of three going on here.
Yeah.
And these big open laughing big mouths, you know. Another one is in episode three, I think for the first time, we see this Carney's poster, another poster that is not a real poster. Oh, and also the cherry orchard, this mouth biting the cherry. That's not, obviously cherry orchard is a real play, but this poster is made up as a prop for this show. So these mouths keep coming back. In Carney's poster, it's a clown, a menacing clown mouth. And if anyone can tell me about this, if this is a real show, I couldn't find any evidence mm-hmm. of Carney's being a real show. Then we see the Salome poster again in Ben's dressing room with the Carney's poster. So in Salome, I take this as Oliver is kind of maybe like King Herod, who is enamored with Loretta / Salome. Mm-hmm. Now in the play, Herod offers Salome anything she desires. Anything at all. After he sees her dance, he falls completely, like, he's just completely enamored by her. She does the Dance of the Seven Veils or the Nanny's Lullaby, maybe.
Mm-hmm. Or even just her monologue.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. I just could not not see Loretta as being related to Salome in a lot of ways. There's a theme in Salome of lust and desire eventually leading to, like, your destruction. So what you're attracted to is, like, your own undoing. There's a lot of moon imagery in Salome as well. There's a comparison of Salome to the moon. And in the Nanny's Lullaby, Loretta sings about moonlight. You know, it's nighttime and she's, you know, also referencing the lighthouse. But the moon could be kind of seen as a lighthouse. It's like a beacon in mm-hmm. the night, you know. So there's also a maternal theme in Salome, especially in the biblical version of Salome. I don't know if there is in as much in the Oscar Wilde version. I can't remember if in Oscar Wilde it is Salome's mother who says, get that John the Baptist's head on a charger. I can't remember if that's in Oscar Wilde's version. But the mouths thing keeps coming up. And the only link that came up in my mind is that Salome falls in love with John the Baptist and she really goes into detail about his red mouth and she mm-hmm. she's lusting after him and she really wants to kiss him. You know, she says, like, I will have you. And when he refuses her, that angers her, obviously. And she demands his head on a charger, on a platter. And then when she gets the head, the severed head in front of her. She kisses his dead head, which leads to her death. I don't know what this means, but I couldn't help but really get the sense that Salome is like Loretta in a lot of ways as I was, going through and researching it all. And I haven't read Salome in years, so let me know if I'm missing something out there. Listeners, everyone in the audience, please.
I love it. That's
And then we get another reference to Bobo being in As You Like It in episode 4. Mm-hmm. And in Kimber's dressing room, we see the poster of Salome. We see a poster of The Importance of Being Earnest, another Oscar Wilde play.
Yeah.
Two brothers in that play who turn out to be the same person. Just saying. Also, big theme of adoption, adopted baby, a baby in a handbag in Importance of Being Earnest. And we also see a poster of the play Mrs. Warren's Profession by George Bernard Shaw, which is about a Victorian, like, high-end prostitute and her daughter. And another, we see the Cherry Orchard poster again. Then in episode 5, Loretta mentions the Merry Wives of Windsor. I couldn't really draw too much of a comparison to this, except that maybe Ben is kind of like Dr. Caius in the way that Dr. Caius abuses his assistant, Rugby, like terribly. But I didn't really get much more from that. But there's a lot of Shakespeare, a lot of classic plays here. Mm-hmm. And just, yeah, those two plays that don't exist, Carney's and Ménage à Trois, both having these weird mouths, these open mouths, like menacing, creepy mouths. I just don't know what to make of all this. So anyone out there who has more information, please share. I would love to hear.
Love it.
Hey, guys. Editing Jade here. So there's a couple of things I forgot to mention. In As You Like It, the two brothers fighting are named Orlando and Oliver. Okay, Oliver banishes Orlando and gets the court boxer named Charles to seriously injure Orlando. Now, in the end, Orlando ends up saving Oliver's life, and the play ends with a wedding. So obviously there's the name connection here, which on further reflection, I have a hard time believing is a coincidence. But maybe this also signifies Mabel in the wedding dress that we see in the trailer. Thoughts? Now, in Mrs. Warren's Profession, Mrs. Warren is an ambitious businesswoman. She is manipulating men by managing a brothel to earn a living. Now, this could be a connection to Kimber wanting to use Ben to promote her anti-aging serum. Also, in episode 4, I realized that we do actually see cast photos on the wall with their role listed beneath. It does say that Jonathan is playing the detective, so I guess he's been officially cast. I have a hard time believing that this will happen because his lack of fame. I mean, how is Donna going to be okay with this? You can't have a Broadway show without a star. So the cast list says Loretta's the nanny, Ty is playing the father, Jonathan's the detective, Kimber is the godmother, Charles is the constable, and Bobo is the narrator. Obviously, the three babies are just prop dolls.
A lot of food for thought.
Speaking of food, there was something that I forgot to mention, just a couple of random clues before I get into my whodunit theory. Clues I forgot to mention that were in my notes from last week were all the food and wine backstage in the dressing room. It seems like an odd thing to mention. Remember when they show up and they're there to see Kimber and they find out that she's running her beauty empire out of the dressing room?
Yeah.
There's all the flowers and wine and food and all the stuff is like, and it's, I think Oliver says it's creepy or gross or something. I don't know. I just thought that was an odd thing to mention.
Yeah.
I'm like, is this a clue? I don't know. Just keep an eye on it. Mm-hmm. There's another clue that always stands out to me, and I forget to mention it. Oliver takes Ben's face in his hands, and he's like, you're alive and so soft. Remember when Ben comes back at the party?
Yes.
And he's alive. Why would you say that to him? I just don't know if it's a clue or not. The only thing I can think is, like, does this mean he's freshly shaven now? He looked pretty freshly shaven at the beginning. I don't know how this is maybe different, but
I don't know. That's a very weird thing to say to somebody, is that you're so
right.
Soft.
It's like, why would you say that, make that comment? It's just so bizarre. It might support the twin theory. I don't know.
Yeah.
There were also, I noticed, I forgot to say, no cookies were found in Ben's dressing room, but I did listen to Only Murders in the Pod. And Adam Shankman was interviewed for the most recent episode of that podcast. And he kind of totally lets a spoiler out, I think. He says, When I found out who Ben was talking to in his dressing room, I laughed so hard. I couldn't stop laughing for like an hour, whatever. He says he laughed so hard. I'm like, why? It's got to be cookies. Mm-hmm. Anyone who thinks that it's not cookies, I'm telling you guys,
it's cookies. I think it's pretty obvious.
I'm pretty sure it doesn't matter. I don't think that it's as important as we're all making it. Everyone is really hooked on this cookie thing. And I'm like, I think it's like a red herring. It's just, it's like, pay attention to this. Who is he talking to? I just don't think it even matters. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's here nor there. I think it's a big old, oh, it's cookies. And guess what? Doesn't really add up to anything.
And it doesn't change anything at this point. I think unless we find that Ben didn't write the message, then it would matter. Because then somebody was in his room.
Okay, so I really want to reiterate that the fucking pig thing, just like the cookies, it's a distraction, it's a misdirect. But just to do my due diligence, Joy, yes, she does say that Ben knew if he touched one hair on that gorgeous head of yours, Charles, he would have me to deal with. But even if she wrote the message as a warning, or no matter who wrote this fucking pig message, just because they wrote it doesn't necessarily make them the murderer. I have a feeling all of the Ben's dressing room nonsense, cookie gate, you know, I think it's a mini mystery that we're all trying to solve right now, and it's just meant to throw us off the main trail. There's also been a lot of talk about Ben's handwriting matching the fucking pig to the card that he wrote to Charles that says, fuck you. Make of it what you will. Here you can see the two handwriting samples side by side. I think that the handwriting was cleverly done by the production so that we could see enough similarity to suspect that it's Ben, but not enough to confirm it. So if you look closely at the letter C, it doesn't really match. The G and the P kind of matches. The only letter that I think is definitely a dead-on match is the N. But again, I think it's a red herring, or a red pig in this case. Okay, one other clue was Oliver says, when he's helping Ben in with his lines, he says, when the curtain goes up in 3 months, trust me, you're gonna kill. Hmm. I feel that that's dramatic irony, that that's foreshadowing or something. I don't know what it means. It just stood out to me on rewatch, you know, that I don't think that Oliver knows anything. I think it just, the line was put into his mouth just to get it in our ears as the audience. Ben's going to kill. And it's like, oh, the irony is he died. Actually, he didn't kill. He died. Mm-hmm. But maybe Ben was behind it somehow.
Yeah. And then even the big banner, I think Kara mentioned it last week when we were watching, that it said, like, you know, about the opening night party, it said something, you're going to kill him or something.
Yeah, right. Yeah. We killed him.
Yeah.
I have a feeling it's like the writers kind of poking at the audience, like, it's right in front of you guys, you see? And the last thing I'll say is that I've been thinking long and hard about it, and I am pretty much off of the idea that Ben is a twin. I think that because everyone is saying it, it can't be that. There's no way that these writers would be that poor all of a sudden to write a mystery where the ending would already be in everyone's mind. I think that if Ben was a twin and if he isn't really dead at all, or if he, you know, Ben was two different people, who knows? I just think that it's too obvious, and the fact that everyone thinks it is an indication that it can't be that. Mm-hmm. So I have a theory about the Ben thing. I still don't know who killed him, but this is what I'm going to start with. Who wrote Death Rattle? We're never told, and I think that this is odd. And no one's ever really even thought to ask this question. I haven't seen anywhere on Facebook or you know, anywhere that I've looked. I haven't really looked on Reddit too much, just on like Facebook, but YouTube, Facebook, I haven't seen anyone ask this question. So what I'm guessing is Oliver was probably told it was written by an anonymous writer. First, I thought Clifford and Donna wrote it, or maybe Ben wrote it himself because he was cast so early on. Then I realized, no, Cliff and Dickie wrote it, either together or maybe just one of them. But okay, this is my theory. Donna and Cliff are obviously not related, right? They are incestuous, and it's played for humor. And this is Disney we're talking about. They're never going to make incest funny.
Yeah, that's true.
There's no way that they're related. So I'm pretty sure that Cliff and Dickie are both adopted, mm-hmm. and they're the twins. Well, they might be the wrong age to be twins. I don't know. They're brothers. They're related.
You might be right. I like go that theory. I like it.
It's going to sound crazy, but go with
me. No, go.
So Ben, that would make Ben the odd brother out because, you know, he's not related. So there's this big thing, you know, the three dolls, two of them are identical. One of them is unique. I think that the unique one is Ben. Mm. So it's not that Ben is a twin. But the only thing I can't explain is the tattoo phenomenon. I don't know. Got nothing for you. If anyone can help me with this, I don't know how these tattoos are changing on his fingers. I know for a fact, though, I really thought about this. That tattoo switch cannot be a production error. Think about it. If you are the actor, Paul Rudd, and you are a good actor and you've been acting for a long time, you would notice on your own freaking hand, mm-hmm. Hey, guys, this is wrong. We can't have that. You know, I would say something if I was him. So the tattoo switch is not, you know, obvious. And also, there's CGI, you know, they can go back and fix things like that in post. So there's no way that this is a mistake. So those tattoos are switched for a reason. I just can't. I don't think that Ben's a twin, but I can't explain those tattoos. So, okay. Cliff and Ben both mention that their childhood, and they both reference the same age, 8 years old. Mm-hmm. Cliff was talking about on his 8th birthday, he was still breastfeeding his mother. Mm-hmm. And Ben said he was supporting his brother and his mother when he was 8 years old and he got fired from Brazos. So it just stood out to me that they would both mention the same age in their childhood. Now, it could also be that Ben and Cliff are actually related, not Cliff and Dickie. Ben and Cliff could be the twins separated at birth because they do seem a lot closer in age and they both reference being 8 years old for some reason. I am almost 100% certain that Dickie is for sure adopted and not related to Ben because there was an article released on August 9th, one day after the premiere on therap.com, and it has character breakdowns for everyone. And under Dickie's, it says he is Ben's adopted brother. I think this was a misprint on the reporter's part. Most likely they got screeners and they watched all 8 episodes before writing this article and they forgot that Dickie being adopted isn't revealed until a later episode. So I saw one post about this on Facebook and that's it. It seems to have like flown under everyone's radar, but I'll link that article for you guys to take a look at and see if you think it's credible or not. So Dickie and Cliff wrote the play mm-hmm. and it was their first writing effort. Cliff convinced Donna to help him produce the play, and that's why he's so invested in the musical. Cliff really wants this musical to happen. And I'm guessing that Dickie doesn't want it to change, and that's why he's so into getting out of there and getting Loretta out of there, getting another job. I think that they basically probably wrote the part for Loretta, and I think Loretta is their aunt. There is that thing on Loretta's refrigerator that I keep bringing up, Aunt Loretta.
Yeah.
So, you know. Now, I think Oliver, it makes sense too why I really thought about this production of the play and how it's getting made. Oliver is the director because he's not established anymore. He's not respected in the community mm-hmm. as a director. He's like a has-been, you know. He's had some flops. So no self-respecting director would take on the project by unknown anonymous playwrights mm-hmm. and with a problematic star, Ben Glenroy, who's probably known to be difficult to work with. So, you know, and Loretta's another unknown. Kimber's like a TikTok star. Like, this is a really wacky sounding, like who would buy that Broadway show?
Right.
So they get Oliver. You know, he's considered to be washed up. He's, you know, his reputation wouldn't be hurt if it was a flop.
Right.
So he took on the job. And I'm thinking Loretta's sister, Dickie and Cliff's mother died. Mm-hmm. Somehow maybe related to the plot of Death Rattle. So maybe the play is autobiographical
maybe.
On Dickie and Cliff's part. And it could be that one of them wrote the play it wasn't a co-writing thing. I feel like it was both of them writing together, though. I don't know. Maybe it was just Cliff.
Do you remember when Oliver first went into Loretta's little book nook, he found the picture of her and she was standing with, I guess, her mother?
Mm-hmm.
Was there anything else about that picture? Because it was so quick. Like, was there anything, like a sign in there just to say where it was? Want to look at it again.
Well, Loretta was raised in Mississippi. That's we got that from her. Mm. She said that. But I don't think there was anything in that photo.
Yeah. I might want to look at it again.
Let's look at it.
Mm. Yeah.
Loretta and her mother. Yeah. Mm. I don't think there's anything
maybe
there.
That's
I can't
not,
really see.
Maybe that's not Loretta. Maybe that's somebody else.
But I mean, what significance would that hold?
True. Unless it's her sister. I don't know.
Oh, yeah. I see what you're saying. I mean, but still, yeah. I mean, it would make more sense if there were two little girls in the picture. I wish there were. That would really support my theory. But yeah.
Yeah. Interesting.
So anyway, so the children, I think Dickie and Cliff were put up for adoption. Loretta couldn't care for them, obviously, because she's in New York. She's got her, she's trying to be an actor, you know, but I think she doesn't have any money to support them. But I think she kept track of them all these years and recently maybe revealed herself to be Dickie's aunt. And I don't know if she knew about Cliff as well, probably. And maybe she didn't know what happened to Cliff and like couldn't keep track of him because she only has the scrapbook for Dickie and Ben.
Right.
So did Donna and Ben know that Loretta was an aunt? Probably not. Why not? I don't know. I just don't think that Donna and Ben knew about this aunt situation. Why the secrecy? Your guess is as good as mine. I'm open to theories. So maybe Dickie and Cliff, either one of them or both of them, killed Ben because he was trying to hurt Loretta. We see him trying to strangle Loretta.
Yeah.
So I'm guessing that Dickie and Cliff are responsible for Ben's death somehow, and then Loretta and Donna are covering it up, or will, you know, be revealed to be covering it up. So is it too on the nose, though, like the play, like exactly like the nanny? I mean, maybe. I don't think I'm completely on the mark here. But I think I'm onto something with this.
I think Cliff you and Dickie are. I think related. That I didn't even think about that, and I like that because you're right.
Once you see it, though, you can't unsee it.
They're really they're really weird, Cliff and Donna. They're like a very odd.
I keep going back to it.
What is odd for this show? Like they're not even like funny. They're just kind of just like
where it's the just hell so. It screamed out to me all of a sudden when I was just like, okay, what the fuck is going on with this incest? And I'm like, it's Disney. This can't be funny. This can't be played for humor. And then I'm like, oh my God, he's adopted. He's the adopted. Okay, now I see it. Ben is not the twin or the triplet. He's the one who's
I like
the
to
different
see that.
One, the different yeah. brother, the third brother. Yeah, so there's some unanswered questions. You know, why did Ben attack Loretta? Was Loretta lying about saying that she was obsessed with him? I mean, it's possible that Ben found out somehow about, like you said, her book, keeping track, her scrapbook, and maybe he took that to mean, like maybe she brought it with her to the theater one night and he found it.
And maybe he thought she was a stalker. Because what did he say to her when he first saw her?
Well, this is one of my unanswered questions. Why is he so complimentary to Loretta at first? And he's like, whoa, the energy coming from here. Am I right? Look at this woman. She's amazing. And then in 2 seconds, he wants to get her fired when he knows what that feels like. And he was traumatized by getting himself kicked off a show after a bad table read. So I'm like, why?
And I mean, at least we know now why he spoke to her the way he did when he came back to life. There, that was, you know, you could see how heated that was. And I mean, and they did answer that she's the one, well, at least through that, like she's the one that caused the red mark. So that's no longer a mystery.
Right. Yeah. So now we know why Charles is saying, stay away from her. I know what you did. I'm pretty sure that I know what you did is like, I know you tried to throw this woman off a balcony, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Which is good. We need some of those questions answered, but there's still so much to cover.
There's also one other thing I wanted to bring up. Who did, I don't know what this means, but who did Kimber sell her hanky to? And maybe that has something to do, because she says she sold it on eBay, I think. That possibly might have something to do with the hanky that Ben was holding. Maybe it was the person who she sold it to is someone.
Just so they still had a hanky?
Yeah, I mean,
I like it.
Anyone can use eBay. You can pick a you know, make up a name and you're on eBay. Mm-hmm. So it could be someone in the cast. It could be someone that we have seen already, or a character that we haven't seen yet that could have bought
it could be somebody who doesn't make a difference one way or another. But yeah, that's a good question.
We don't know what happened to that hanky. We can account for all hankies except Kimber's, and Ben was holding a hanky, so it's got to be somebody's. Well, actually, we can't account for... Oh, this is... Yeah, this is getting into my next thing. Howard, we can't account for his hanky or KT's. It shocks me that Mabel didn't say, well, what about the hankies that Howard and KT have? We got to get theirs, too. All she says is, like, get the hankies. And, I mean, she says, we got all the hankies except for Kimber's. But we never see them ask Howard or KT for their hanky. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. There's that too.
Yeah.
I don't know it's if it's
dropped
just,
a little
it's
bit.
Like, yeah, it's a plot. It's a plot line that was dropped weirdly. And it could be because it's a clue and it's intentionally dropped. Who knows?
Yeah.
But Howard, I can't discount Howard. And when I really think to myself, okay, could it be Howard? He kind of is like Poppy. He's hiding in plain sight. He's always there. He's always ever present. Eyes and ears everywhere. He has access.
A lot of power. He has a lot of power in his season.
He's got a lot of power. He's got a lot of knowledge of what's going on. He's always kind of on the inside. He's a fly on the wall, right? Mm-hmm. And if it were to be revealed that Michael Cyril Creighton, series favorite, like everyone loves him. He's like probably the fan favorite, you know, of the show. If it was revealed that he was the killer, I mean, how cool would that be? Like, Howard. Mm-hmm. And Howard's got some skin in the game because I remembered Howard wants to be an actor. He, from season one, remember when Oliver was doing the lineup of like, mm-hmm. who killed Tim Kono? And he was like, had his flash dancer, you know?
Yeah. Gear. And he was, and then he was singing Joseph. What was it?
Yes, Joseph.
My coat of many colors.
My coat of many colors. Yeah, in season two. So, and then in season three, yeah, he didn't get in the show. Oliver said, be my assistant instead. So there's
I like that. That's a lot.
He's got some angst. Motive. Yeah, a little bit of motive. Another motive for him possibly being just like what I was saying last episode, like he could be only responsible for Ben's collapsing just to push Jonathan on stage opening night. Mm-hmm. If he would have been around and in the position to overhear the fight with Loretta, and he could have overheard her say fucking pig, and he could have been the one to write it on the mirror.
Mm-hmm. That's true.
Mm. However, the one thing that tells me it's probably not Howard is he is always pushing State Farm insurance. And State Farm is a sponsor of Only Murders in the Building. So would they want the murderer to be their spokesperson? I don't know. I don't think so.
I don't know. Mm. That's a good point.
Yeah, that's all I got. It's not a whole lot. It's mostly just I rewatched for clues. I rewatched in pieces.
I love, love, love. Like, and I think just because of how they kind of said that they're going to use the set intentionally, that like with Poppy last season, like they put all those different clues.
Yeah.
But I like that. But it also because it's from classic literature that maybe some people who haven't had that exposure to those, they won't catch them as quickly.
Totally. Yeah. You have to go and really do your research. And that's what I'm saying.
And you have
like,
to know the themes. It's not going to just be something obvious. But no,
luckily
I like
for
it.
Me, I it's like, this is the one thing I know. Like I have Jeopardy-ish knowledge about it. Yeah. Like theater, plays. I know these things. Yes. So I didn't have to do as much Googling as probably the average bear.
I hope a lot of that does come true because I like that. I think...
It's real easy to throw a reference up like a play poster because it's like I was saying, it's loaded.
It's,
you know,
yeah.
You're saying so much with just a poster.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but you are noticing the different themes and the mouths, multiple mouths, especially if they're really
rattle.
Foreboding.
I forgot to mention that too. The only other mouth thing we get in this is the dummy has that big rattle in its
horrible.
Mouth.
Yeah.
And that was very menacing looking, kind of like those laughing mouths on the posters. So that was another connection I made. And also Ben was bleeding from his mouth when he allegedly bit his tongue.
Mm-hmm. I think there's something
there.
If
anyone can shed some light, please, listeners, I'm begging you, man. No one, we didn't get a lot of feedback this week, but please,
let's
feedback.
Let's hear.
Yeah, like, come on, guys.
We want not like hot takes or like... wild and expanded theories.
Tell me why I'm full of shit, please. I dare you. Tell
You're
me
not
why
full of shit.
I'm wrong. I probably am. I'm probably wrong on so many things. But yeah, let me know what you think about this Dickie and
I like it. I like it a lot.
The twin theory being Dickie and Cliff. Mm. Some predictions that I have coming up in the future. is to do with the Shakespeare thing. The next episode is called Ghostlight. And there is a film with Carol Kane and Carrie Elwes called Ghostlight. And guess what that, allow me to read you a brief synopsis. A dark comedy about a disgruntled summer stock actor who contemptuously disregards the superstition surrounding Shakespeare's tragedy, Macbeth. Ooh. Just saying, people. Just saying.
I think you got it. More Shakespeare. You're on to something, Jade.
Well, and Macbeth is, you know, killing a king, another killing a king thing. Mm-hmm. You know, it's ambition, and it's a woman kind of behind it all. A woman behind, yeah. You know, controlling. And also there's a theme of three in Macbeth. You got the three witches. And people have been bringing up, like, the fact that Loretta says she's cursed, and, like, there's mm-hmm. all these. I heard someone on Facebook talk about the cranes. There's a lot of origami in Loretta's apartment. We see mm-hmm. it. We see yeah. it on, why has she got all this origami at a table read, you know? And someone said it's a link to witchcraft. And I'm like, oh, I've never heard of this, but maybe. Okay.
I'm going to look into that. Origami is linked to witchcraft?
I have no idea. They said maybe it's a pagan thing. And I'm like, okay, I don't know. Yeah. I predict, though, that Mabel will eventually join forces with Cinda Canning. I don't think that's there for no reason. Mm-hmm. It pisses me off because I fear that it's going to split up our trio. I hope it doesn't.
Yeah, because the podcast hasn't even started.
Has not started, yeah.
No.
Yeah. And I also think that next episode, I called it episode 6. I think Loretta will find out about Oliver's heart problems and she'll try to stop him from directing. Or her worry will somehow get in the way of the show. That's what mm-hmm. I'm guessing. And I also, the one suspicion that I had about Taubert was that maybe he's working for Cinda Canning, or maybe he will work. Like, if Mabel says, I won't work with you, I'm not going to join forces, maybe she'll approach Taubert. And Taubert, mm-hmm. being on the inside of the investigation, maybe he'll be feeding Cinda information. I don't know that Cinda's so nefarious, though, that she would do something like that, but something I thought about.
Yeah. I need Mabel to stay away from toxic relationships.
Right? I know. Seriously.
Either be, like, on her own, like, completely solo, do something solo, or stay with your two best buds.
Yeah, I've been saying it. I don't need Mabel to be romantically attached to anybody. No. So it's a bit of a bummer, and it's a bit of a retread that they're doing that again. But, you know, Jesse Williams... They and Jesse Williams, you could do a lot worse. They've got great chemistry. I'm not that mad at it, you know?
Yeah.
Okay, now we do get a couple of clues in the credits. So in episode 1, the ending credits, we see the Death Rattle poster, mysteriously without the writer's name on it, which is odd for a Broadway poster. And we also see Ben's Indiana Jones-like detective hat. In episode 2, we see the Cobro 3 movie poster. Okay, there's the number 3, which we're seeing a lot. And then we see Greg Rivera's security badge with an ID number 8291902. I don't know if this is a clue. I'm just throwing it out there. Episode 3, we see the Death Rattle Dazzle poster, still without a writer's name. And we see 3 baby carriages in the poster and 3 figures of people. Okay, more 3s coming up. And then we have the hanky with the baby rattles. Episode 4, we see Kimber's serum bottle and the orange Statue of Liberty, which was in the fish tank. Now, something that I thought of, what is the Statue of Liberty, right? It's sort of a female lighthouse. Another connection to Loretta, maybe. I don't know. Let me know what you guys think. Episode 5, the ending credits are the Ruby Strippers, Joy's lipstick, and the article of Ben, the t-shirt gate. He wore this inappropriate t-shirt to meet the Pope. Not quite sure how it all fits together yet, but chances are these are clues that will help us solve the mystery, so I'm just keeping track of it all here.
Yeah.
I also wonder if there's something to what Saz said about Ben's death actually having been meant for Charles, because we do see those sandbags falling on stage in the trailer and just barely mm-hmm. missing Charles. So she might be right about that. Also, it's so sad when she tells him that people on social media are like wishing it had been him that died instead of Ben. I'm like, wow, Saz, geez, you needed to tell him that? God. All right, that is all we have to say. That was a lot. It was, that was a woof. That was a lot.
Got to take off that, you know, your little detective hat and pull your pipe for a little bit.
Take off my Sherlock costume.
Yes.
Although I probably won't because I never do. So now it is time for Jade's favorite thing in the world, my feedback crack. And we did just get a little bit of feed crack. It's not quite enough to get high on. I'm going to need more in the future. Guys, come on. I'm an addict over here. I need my fix. Help me out.
Nom nom. It's Evelyn Marie Morris. Nom nom.
Well, we did get an email.
Yes. All right. So listen here. Hello, enchanting Erica, kick-ass Kara, and jackpot Jay the Pirate.
I love it, matey.
Yes. Episode 4, OMG, where do I start? This episode was full of marvelous moments. The visits to the White Room, brilliant.
Brilliant.
Jan's impression. Oh, Jan. You mean Joy's impression of an animal. But yes, I could see the connection of Jan and Joy.
Yep.
Batshit crazy, but fucking hilarious. Mabel baiting Howard with that can only be described as sweater pillow talk. And of course, everything Oliver said. That's it from me. I'm short on time and need to grab a mirror and celebrate my vulva. We all need to go do that. The Roanoke Greenway hero, Liz, with a double Z.
Oh, Liz. I love you so much. Always.
Love it.
Huge smile to my face. Mwah, Liz, love you. Okay, the next comment is on YouTube from Wasted Poe. Couple of random thoughts. I'm starting to get a sinking feeling regarding the theory that Ben was talking to Cookies in his dressing room. His dialogue was so clearly signaling Cookies that I assume the writers would be aware of how obvious it was. Surely one of the main characters would have brought up the cookie possibility in the next episode. Well, they didn't, but sad. Except no one did. And now we see fucking pig written on the mirror, which would also be consistent with the idea that Ben was talking about Cookies. I worry that the writers are going to drag out this particular mystery until late in the season and then reveal it was Cookies all along, not realizing that the audience got it right away. I think you're dead on. I think you're dead right about that. I think that it was something. But again, I think that this is a clue that people are making a bigger deal than it is. I think that the reason that everyone's getting it is because, it's easy to get and it doesn't actually matter that much.
Yeah, we're not going to learn anything from this.
A big part of a magic trick is the misdirect. And it's saying, look over here, look at the razzle dazzle. Mm-hmm. Meanwhile, they're doing something behind your back real sly. Mm-hmm. And that's the actual real trick. So, I have a feeling that this cookie thing is just a big old distraction mystery. It's a red herring mystery. Mm-hmm. The Cinda Canning reinvention is interesting. I don't know if the episode explicitly stated this, but I hope her temporary career change was intended to address something that bothered me about season 2, which is that Cinda Canning would have no reason to help the trio bring Poppy to justice. In fact, I can easily imagine a variation of season 2 that involved Cinda Canning helping Poppy get away with it all. Yeah. Because the way things shook out, Cinda Canning would have been implicated in Poppy's crimes. After the season finale, there would have been a scandalous criminal trial, and Cinda would have to defend herself and convince the court she had no idea what was going on. And even if she avoided jail time, her career would be over. She'd be seen as a fraud, since her career was founded on a lie that resulted in an innocent man, the mayor, I think, going to jail. Anyway, I hope that Cinda's new appearance is meant to acknowledge that season 2 would unavoidably have resulted in fallout for her. Yes, she does say that she was canceled. And I was kind of shocked by that. I was like, but it's kind of unfair. I mean, but that's the way the world works. People get unfairly canceled all the time.
Mm-hmm.
So,
I think those are all valid.
Yeah, it's a really good point. And I never really thought to be bothered by that in my rewatch of season 2. I think I was just focused on other things. But yeah, it's true. It is more likely that Cinda would have been helping Poppy get away with it rather than Cinda being completely oblivious to what Poppy was doing. Mm-hmm. But Cinda is incredibly selfish. So easy to assume as well that she would not notice people right in front of her doing something nefarious, you know?
Yeah, yeah, very
That she
true.
Wouldn't notice Poppy and Krebs were working together.
Yeah.
Yes, thank you, Wasted Poe. Appreciate it.
Awesome. Our next comment's from Instagram, from Michelle Noel Moore. OMG, I just tried to send you a message and Siri had a field day with my fast talking and it said something naughty. Oh, you should have just sent it anyway. So sorry. Anyway, Ashley Park is a Broadway actress. She was in the Mean Girls on Broadway. Yes, she played, I think, Gretchen. This season is obviously very Broadway centric. I would bet if you don't know someone, they have been on Broadway. Even the guy they have playing the piano has been on Broadway and he's crazy talented. It's Joel Wagoner. Check his stuff out. Yes.
Right on.
Thank you, Michelle.
Yeah, we mentioned that the Ashley Park was on Broadway after we had to Google it. I can't believe I forgot that she was in Mean Girls. Yeah.
Yeah. Very
Thank
cool.
you so much, Michelle. And that's all the feedback that we have. So guys, please leave us your feedback. only going to say it one more time. Leave us your feedback. Okay, that's all I'm going to say. Stop saying it. That's all I'm going to say about my unnecessarily shitty lack of feedback. Get it? Since I don't have a dressing room to complain about. All right, guys, that's going to wrap it up for episode 5. But if it's more murder mystery you crave, we are here to oblige. My friend Paul and I are about to start a new murder mystery series. We're going to do a podcast on it too, but really we're focusing on YouTube videos. They're going to be a little shorter, bite-sized movie reviews. And we're about to record our first one, which is Clue, the 1985 murder mystery classic, my gateway drug into murder mysteries. It was the very first murder mystery I ever saw as a child. And it holds a very special place in my heart. So
it's a masterpiece. Love it.
I'm so excited to talk about this film. If you want a good, you know, comedy murder mystery, and if you've never seen Clue, you got to give it a watch. It's, for me, it's incredible. We're about to record that now, and that should be up and available in a couple of days after this episode is published. So be on the lookout. And yeah, if you are liking the podcast, just give those 5 stars a good smacking. We'd really appreciate it. And leave us a review if you are so inclined. A favorable review, please. Make it favorable. And leave us your feed crack. Ah, I need it. I need my fix. Give it to me.
Yes.
Nom nom.
Yes, write to us or leave us a voice message. And in the meantime,
voice messages.
Yes, please leave us your feedback on episode 5. You may email us at perfectlymarvelouspodcast@gmail.com or DM us on Instagram at perfectlymarvelouscast or join our only Perfectly Marvelous Murders in a Building Facebook group.
Yes, we'd really love to get a discussion, more of a discussion going on there, guys. So I know there's a lot of Only Murders in the Building Facebook groups, but give ours a visit every now and again and share your theories over there as well. And share the podcast with fellow mystery lovers you might know. And if you want to follow me on Instagram, it's Jade the Naked Lady, all one word. And it's Jade8Green on TikTok. That's 8, like the number 8, not A-T-E. I didn't eat green, although I eat my greens on the regular.
You might eat Mr. Green when you do your Clue.
Oh, God, no, I'm not eating Mr. Green. Ooh, Lord.
Now she's more Miss Scarlet, huh?
Yeah, that's... Oh, Lord. Although Martin Mull is lovely, I just don't fancy him that way.
Yeah.
Yes, all the links to all of these things are in the description of the podcast. And now, my loves, I have had a marvelous time talking with you all. Thank you so much, lovely listeners, for joining us.
Yes, and come back next time for our review of Season 3, Episode 6, Ghostlight. I'm Erica.
And I'm Jade.
Thank you and good night.
Groovy doobie.
Do you doobie, baby?
Indeed, I doobie. Spark it. Spark it, baby.
Got to get some purple streamers.
Smoke them if you got them. Right?